Blizzard campus. I personally love going around there. It's super fun, and it just looks, it is as fun as it looks. Just let me be clear on that. So I'm joined on the couch. Before we go into the semifinals, I want to do a quick interview with ESL's Charles Watson. He's also known as Milkcast. He put on a lot of community productions last year, but now he works officially for ESL. I think it's a cool opportunity while we get ready and let the quarterfinals reset their minds in preparation for the semis to just talk a little bit about Season 1 journey all the way to Season 2. So the first thing I want to ask, Charles, is how are you doing? How are you enjoying Season 2 so far?
I think it's going really well. Season 1 obviously was pretty cool. I think one of the first really big Hearthstone tournaments to do opens in a big way. But we've definitely come a long way. I mean, who would have thought that 150 people would be here in person watching, or 80,000 people watching open play online? So it's definitely going really well. I mean, I think I'm having fun. I think everyone's having fun.
I would say they're definitely having one of the best times of their life. I might be, you know, extrapolating a little bit, but I think it's fair to say. Let's talk a little bit about that, Opens versus Invitationals. As a tournament organizer, what does ESL hope to achieve specifically in Season 2 that you were building with the momentum in Season 1, having Sandstorm as that winner that people were really surprised about, but to a lot of the players, it was very deserved?
Well, I think Sandstorm's actually kind of the right story to kind of kick this off with. Sorry, Chalky. Oh, this is awkward. So, Dan, just you and me talking now.
Hey, Charles, what am I doing here? Why am I in the shot?
I don't know. Just run with it, man.
Get your arm off.
You know, Sandstorm's a good example. Sorry, Chalky. He qualified through Open in Season 1. He made it to LAN. He won the LAN. And we were ready to invite him back for Season 2 because, I mean, I'm a big fan of Chalky. We talk pretty frequently outside the game, but I'm also a huge fan of Sandstorm. And it's like, yeah, great player, let's get him back. But at the same time, we kind of created this open ecosystem where we didn't need to invite Sandstorm back. Literally, the week we were going to invite him back, he qualified for Open. And it's like, oh, okay, qualified for LAN, boom, done. That's kind of what we're trying to do. It's like, yeah, a lot of players like, you know, Kaleno and Trump maybe don't have time to play through an open tournament we put on the weekend. But anyone with time should be able to play through the open, win the open, make it to LAN, have a great time. Domdis, Kabi, Demigod, like Kit Kats out of nowhere. Like really awesome players making it through open, having a great time here in the studio. That's really what we wanted to do.
What are some of the lessons learned from Season 1? Because not everything obviously went according to plan, I would imagine, considering that some things definitely were a little rocky, but it seems like as you transitioned to Season 2, as the season went on, it was really strong. What were some of the most valuable things ESL learned as they picked up the pieces?
Well, open tournaments are really hard to run. That's it, period. End of discussion. We built a really great admin team. I think we're running bar none the best actual tournaments in Hearthstone right now. So huge shout out to the admin team. I also think we're doing the best productions in Hearthstone, so shout out to the production as well. I mean, we're really making it happen.
Do you think this is what Hearthstone needs? Because a lot of people complain about opens versus invitationals, but they don't really focus on things like production values and smoothly ran administrative tournaments until it explodes, right? Then when production goes wrong, then they start creating some fires, or if something goes wrong administratively, the open tournaments end up crumbling. What, in your opinion, is something that is missing here at all that ESL is trying to work on or bring in the future?
More Chalky, for one. Yeah, more Chalky, period. End of discussion.
What's been the most interesting story in Season 2 finals so far to you? We have four players remaining. We have Reynad, who just beat Life Coach, Kickass, who took out Trump, of course, coming back into the relevance as he sort of disappeared for a little bit of time, but he's back as strong as ever. Then we have Demigod and Phonetap, two unknown players. Which is the most appealing story to you and why?
I think we were able to finally shut up Reynad and the community about bad RNG. I love Reynad. I love Life Coach. It's really, I'm glad they got to the quarterfinals together. I think they're two excellent players, but I think this is maybe Reynad's time to shine. It's his tournament win.
All right. Well, hopefully we can see that dream come true, but at the same time, three other people are trying to do it at the same time as well. And with that, I guess we want to go ahead and ask if there's anything else you want to address the community on behalf of ESL. This has been another breakthrough season, which has been hard because ESL, it's very ambitious for them to do something with such a new studio because they confuse it with ESL America versus actual ESL in Europe. So go ahead and just address the community here on behalf of ESL as you prepare to close out the season.
Yeah, well, follow us on Twitter, at ESL Hearthstone. Follow the Twitch channel. I think season three is going to be even bigger and better.
So there will be a season three.
Oh, I'm fired. I'm out of here.
And that's my job. That wraps up the interview. Thank you so much, Charles, for stopping by. And a great job for season two, I think, on behalf of everyone here. It's been a great time. But we're not done yet. We're just getting to the good part. Semifinals is about to begin. So we send it over to Crip, TJ, and Firebat to see what's going to be coming up next.
Thanks a lot, Froden. We were just talking about that Reynad moment. Not that unlikely. Could have happened to anyone.
Unstable portal into Corkon Elite.
Yeah, you got Arcane Golem. You got Wolf Rider with the extra mana to ping. You got... there's one more.
Reckless Rocketeer.
No, Leroy, though.
Leroy.
Yeah, 1%. No big deal. Happens to everybody.
Yeah. Well, we'll see if Reynad's going to be able to pull it out. But the next matchup, the first semifinal of the day, is going to be Demigod taking on Phonetap.
Yeah, both very, very dominant players. Both coming through the open brackets, both relatively unknown, both looking to prove themselves. Crip, who do you think is going to win?
Well, Demigod qualified first in his group. I believe Phonetap qualified second.
Mm-hmm.
So let's give it to Demigod.
Just going off pure
That's what
brackets
we got.
Yeah.
Working off what we got.
Yeah.
All right, well, let's take a look at the bracket for the day. Both semifinals are set. Demigod versus Phonetap is going to be first up, and then, of course, the second semifinal of the day, Kit Kats and Reynad. One of these four players is going to be crowned the Season 2 Legendary Series champion, and it's sort of a great story. The top of the bracket is the players that made it to the open bracket. Mm-hmm. We have Demigod and Phonetap.
Yeah, but not only that, but they actually have the most unusual decks.
Yeah.
Demigod
yeah,
has, like, a crazy setup to just to isolate few decks, while Phonetap has, well, not
those decks.
Not
yeah, Hunter.
Those ones.
He's got Hunter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which could be potentially isolated. The Mech Shaman also could be really difficult to find a win with against the Paladin with the Seal of Light and other anti-aggressive tech.
Yep.
It sounds like you actually can't beat that.
Yeah, that seems really hard for him to beat, so he's probably going to open with the Paladin. But yeah, sneaking a win with that Mech Shaman might be a little bit tricky.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. On the other side of the bracket.
It is Conquest format. You got to look for that deck that can't win.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really the key. It's not the one that can win.
Yeah.
There's usually a few of those.
Yeah.
It's the last one.
Yeah. That, I think Mech Shaman is going to be the hardest one for Phonetap to be able to get a win with.
Right.
He's going to need one of those explosive starts, get all the early game out there, and maybe stabilize a Whirling Zap-O-Matic. Something needs to happen.
Yeah.
But Paladin, as we sort of guessed, that's what he's going to lead with. Yeah, Paladin just lines up well against all three of Phonetap's decks.
So, Demigod, the only player still left in the tournament who has not lost a match.
Wow.
Made it through first in his groups.
Yeah.
Won in the quarterfinals. All the other three players that made it through into the semifinals came out second from their group.
That's right.
So, undefeated in matches.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
True
oh, man.
Demigod level.
Yeah.
Not the strongest hand in the world, but he does have the quality combo to sort of stall if the druid has some sort of ridiculous opening.
I was actually thinking about that. He's got the equality super combo. It's equality pyromancer coin.
Yeah. The super combo.
It used to be a thing with Holy Light, like, way back.
Yeah.
You know about that?
Yeah, I know about that.
Yeah, that's cool. Whenever that happened, I was like, whoa!
Well, now the new super combo is, like, Pyromancer Equality into the draw spell after it wipes the whole board.
Solemn Vigil.
Oh, okay. Solemn Vigil.
Yeah,
I like it. Then you just reload your hand.
Yeah.
Oh, Wild Growth's a pretty good
My
top deck.
My greetings.
Sorry about that.
Phonetap.
I was
actually playful.
About to say that even though Paladin does do well against all three, it seems like it does least well against the Druid.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
So this is favorable matchup for Phonetap then.
Mm-hmm. Wouldn't say favorable matchup overall. He's still unfavored in the matchup, but Paladin's least good against this one.
Yeah.
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 This Paladin deck does not run Muster for Battle or Quartermaster. It's very, very control heavy.
Yeah, his cards suck.
What?
Actually, because it doesn't run Muster for Battle, it's maybe going to struggle a bit against the Hunter.
Yeah, that's true. Maybe it could. Yeah. It's all going to depend on if he's able to get Wild Pyromancer in time or if he's able to get Minibot in time.
Or Sealed Light can be a pretty good tool against Hunter as well. Yeah. Deals with Knife Jugglers without taking damage.
Seal of Light plus Wild Pyromancer is really good.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Man, that game face. Can we just look at him for a second?
At Demigod?
Yeah,
he looks angry.
Yeah, I would be. Wild Growth turn 2, are you kidding?
Yeah,
that's just not fair.
He's
the next Mana Crystal every turn.
Yes, he's not responding very well.
Whoa, that
he could kill
is...
that,
he can. It just sucks.
It just sucks. Yeah. If he could kill it efficiently, then it would take out the Shade, which would be huge.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, he's unable to. So I guess we're just going to see another Piloted Shredder come down, try and fight for tempo. That's really the most important thing against Druid.
Yeah.
Any deck against Druid, if you can get ahead on tempo on Druid, Druid really struggles.
Piloted Shredder really
back
sucks because it's going to be Shade into Shredder and then Sheep into 2-3. It's going to clear both, probably, so Druid gets full board.
Mm-hmm. Wow, yeah. Maybe he will just Hero Power instead, but then you're just surrendering the board.
No, if the Druid had a card to play, you would be winning the board. It just so happens that he doesn't have a card to play.
Yeah.
Now he has the same no card to play.
Yeah. I mean, a 2-4 is a body.
Yes.
Yeah.
That is a fact.
Well, actually... Yeah. What you can do is sheep into the 2-3 and then silence the Shredder and Hero Power it down.
Yeah, I like that a lot better.
Hmm. Yeah, that seems very reasonable. You preserve your Shade. It's a little bit weak, but it's still preserved.
Yeah, and you take 2 more damage, but you keep 2 health on your Keeper.
Yeah.
And you really want sticky minions with Savage for combo in hand.
Health is also probably your greatest resource in this matchup because Demigod's deck is not fast. Yeah. At all. He's not just going to burst you down unless he has the tempo to do it.
Yeah.
So.
Huh. Well, that would have been good last turn.
Yeah, that would have been really good last turn. That would have been perfect. Now what do we do here? You could Seal a Light to potentially just knock off the Shade, but then you're not really developing anything behind it.
Yeah.
So maybe just playing Sludge Belcher is a little bit better. But
yeah. I think I like Sludge Belcher.
Yeah, me as well. That Shade is just so annoying, though. Because now's your opportunity to kill it, and maybe next turn it hides behind taunts, and you don't have that opportunity.
No, I think the second a taunt comes down, it's Pyromancer.
Yeah.
Clears the board.
Yeah.
But I don't think you have that to worry about. I think Sludge Belt is just fine.
Mm-hmm.
I think, actually, whatever you play this turn doesn't really matter. Unless you do something dumb with a Pyro this turn. That would be dumb. But I think everything else is fine.
Everything else. Even just, like, Yulbot?
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, because you're just setting up to Equality next turn, most likely, anyway.
Oh, look at that. Equality.
Yeah, but the Druid still gets to draw 2 cards off the Ancient Allure and refresh his hand after the Equality.
Mm-hmm.
So you're going to lose everything. So all you're doing is resetting the board. You're not going to be playing any minions that turn besides maybe a dude. And then the Druid has 2 new cards to just go in and refill the board on.
Yeah, Ancient Allure is probably the best card to have in defense of Equality, even though that's not something that he expects.
Yeah.
It would be the best since he's refilling his hand.
Yeah. If he, however, goes for like some sort of like Druid of the Claw Hero Power play just to push through that Belcher, then he's going to get punished pretty heavily because it's going to be a lot more awkward to play the Ancient Allure.
Yeah.
But still not that awkward. It's still pretty good for the Druid.
I just kind of like Druid of the Claw in charge.
Huh.
Push damage.
Push damage. You do have combo in your hand already.
Yeah.
Do you like it in bear form?
I think I like it in charge better.
I don't know if... He knows his deck. This is the Heliodin. He's got ridiculous amounts of healing decks. He's got Seal of Light, Guardian of Kings, Lay on Hands, Antique Healbot.
Well, this Sylvanas time.
This board does not look good enough for the Equality combo, so I would definitely prefer to see Sylvanas.
Yeah. Oh, look at that. You can True Silver down a bear. Not often you see that.
Yeah. That True Silver down a bear and heal up.
That's not
more
a bad
damage
thing.
Than it actually did.
Yeah.
Yeah. That would not be bad.
I think I like Sylvanas better, though. It's just hard to deal with.
Yeah, especially since you've already seen one Keeper of the Grove.
Yeah.
So it's pretty unlikely that it's going to get silenced.
Yeah,
but
it is.
Well, obviously, he doesn't know that.
Mm-hmm. Actually, it might not. And if he doesn't, like, the Pyro has, like, huge punish.
Yeah.
Like, if he attacks into it with the bear and his Pyro Seal Light.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And steal
that
something.
That could be devastating.
Yeah.
You want to have something for
gonna be
Tyrion.
A 5/5.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You want to have something for
well,
Tyrion.
It could be a 2/3. Well, 2/2.
2/2.
Yeah.
5/4.
Yeah.
But if it gets the 5/4, and you can kill the 2/2,
then
that's
a good
spot. Horrifying.
Yeah.
So a lot of crazy stuff could happen in the next two turns here.
Yeah, definitely. This is going to be a deciding moment coming up soon.
I have no time.
And he is going to go with the Sylvanas point.
I like how basically everyone at this stage in the tournament is waiting for the midpoint of the rope to play anything.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah, there's a lot, I guess. Well, a lot on the line for these
for
guys.
Them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So in this situation, do you think it's too much of a slowdown in tempo to silence?
Apparently.
He does.
Yeah.
Yeah, but...
Whoa.
Innervate can do some interesting things.
I don't think you're worried about it too much because outside of the Pyromancer, he doesn't have any way to sort of like kill off his Sylvanas.
Yeah.
So it's...
Well, this is a...
He's not too worried about
if
it.
If any creature sticks, then... If he doesn't heal, he's going to be dead.
Oh, it looks like he's going to do the super safe play.
Yeah. But this also gets to... Yeah.
Yeah. He's going to kill off the Druid of the Claw, heal up, and be able to just fully clear the board, so... I mean, this is sort of that turning point. Once Druid loses the board, it's sort of hard for them to...
No, it's not.
...rebuild it.
His combo with Innervate just needs another Savage Roar. There's no rebuilding.
Yeah.
But he's got a lot of heal.
I've seen.
There's another.
I've seen Heliodin versus combo druid, and it was like a stealth shade plus like double combo, and it just didn't matter. It was 32 damage. Like you can't heal.
Yeah, yeah.
You need to push some pressure, or else you're just not going to win.
Yeah, that's usually one of the ways this matchup ends up. And that lore off the top is huge. He didn't really have anything to do this turn, and the lore gives him a pretty good turn, unless he's thinking about like keepering and swiping face to try and set up combo.
I like a keeper swipe face.
Really?
I don't like it when I see both hands.
Yeah.
But when I see his, I like it.
Yeah.
Taking the opportunity to draw. Whoa.
Wow, two innervates.
So he could actually force it. He can actually combo and swipe.
Yeah, he could innervate out the turn. Swipe here just to sort of protect his Ancient Allure.
Combo and swipe. That is hilarious.
No one expects the old 18 damage combo.
It looks like he's going to play the Shade, set up for a bigger combo board.
Yeah, it's just easy quality ever.
But still, qualitying two minions doesn't feel the greatest.
I don't know if he's ever going to have more than two, though.
Yeah. And you don't have anything to develop behind it besides Iron Beak Owl and a dude.
You don't equality. You're not dead, but...
You want to just a quality trade healbot?
Let me think.
I mean, you could a quality trade and just Emperor.
You could just trade healbot.
Yeah, you could just trade healbot. And you just trade Guardian again. Yeah. That's way better than all the other options.
Right, two. Yeah. Well.
So it sets you outside of combo range while developing a large enough minion to actually do something.
The Druid is drawn a lot. At this stage, you're weighing in the risk of more than just combo.
Yeah. Yeah, you've seen him holding a lot of cards.
Is there a way to play around double combo with one of these?
No. I don't think you can ever play around double combo,
double
really.
Double combo is 22, and with the 3 attack on board, that's another. That's 29.
Yeah, so even if he anti-keelbought it with the extra heal, you wouldn't be able to play around it, so...
I mean, that's kind of why Druid does pretty okay. I didn't realize this Palmec was this slow. I knew
it was very
like,
slow.
Yeah, I knew it was kind of slow, but like if it's this slow, I actually think it's not a good matchup for Paladin at all.
Yeah, maybe not. Just because Druid has enough time to get to their double combo every game.
Yeah.
So it might actually be a Druid favorite matchup just because the Paladin is so slow.
Same reason why Patron Warrior does well against slow decks, because you just give them time, they're just going to draw into all their pieces, and the more options they have, the easier it is for them to just get to the point where they can combo you down.
I feel like any play that involves combo this turn is not that great.
Yeah, because you want to save for that double combo, just take the game pretty slow. 30 him.
If anything, you can just... I think you can swipe the Guardian, then swipe face, then hero power down the Guardian.
Yeah.
Solid.
Keeper, you keep Keeper to allow you to get through something like Tyrion, like something that would otherwise like close you out of the game.
Yeah, you have to hold on to the Keeper. And he's going to break up the combo pieces. Now if he gets a Savage Roar off the top, that Innervate's going to be pretty useless. But he is setting up Lethal. So that's sort of the idea behind it.
Yeah, he's setting up Lethal, but it's a Lethal setup that can lose him the game.
Yeah, and he's against Heliodin, expecting no more heals.
Yeah.
Yeah. It might not be...
I don't like that play at all.
I don't like it at all either.
Well...
It's going to go back up to 11.
And then even swipe, innervate, keeper.
He's only 10.
It's only 10.
It's not enough.
So he could... A draw next turn to win him the game would be second Force of Nature, because that would be 11 damage with Innervate Hero Power. Exactly.
All right.
So he does have a draw to win the game.
Yeah, he can't Unstable Portal Corcoran Elite.
I really want to see Pyromancer here. I think he has to win somewhat quickly at 11 HP.
Yeah. I mean, here he can just Sludge Belcher and Hero Power the face.
Yeah.
I would just
Hero Power face.
Not even play Sludge Belcher?
No. I mean, without any doing any more damage.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. Yeah.
It's like, have your 10 health.
Just hero power. Oh my god,
why not
it's 5
the
cards.
Belcher?
Yeah.
It trades very, at least decently on board. It's really
like,
Guardian
I think things. I think Phonetap has this game just because it's the damage is too sneaky.
Yeah, no one expects the double swipe innervate keeper of the grove.
It's like,
yeah. Well, we thought about it the last turn, and we said, well, any play with combo is probably the worst that he could do, and then he ended up going for it. So I don't know what he's thinking.
Yeah, if Demigod's able to top deck something like a Guardian of Kings, though, even though the damage is really sneaky, he'll probably just play Guardian of Kings.
Yeah. I think he only runs one. I think Lay on Hands is the. He's healed a lot. He's anti-heal botted, Guardian of Kings, and Seal of Lighted already.
I think slow decks generally run Lotheb too, don't they?
This one doesn't.
Okay.
Lotheb's been falling out of favor a lot lately in every deck, not just slow or fast.
Oh, he's dead.
Yeah, he's pretty dead.
Yeah. He's definitely
dead. Yeah. Well, I mean, things could happen.
Oh, yeah. Like,
things.
Internet.
Yeah,
go
internet,
down.
Seizures.
Well, no. I think in that situation, the rule book says if he's got 100% lethal on board, even if he disconnects things happen.
You could actually... Equality and then silence your Guardian for a full heal.
Yeah, but you'd still die.
Yeah, but it's a cool play.
Yeah, but it doesn't re-initialize the battle cry.
Crypt's all about the cool plays.
If you're gonna lose, that's a cool way to lose.
Go out in style?
Yeah.
Alright.
Alright, well, here comes the double swipe innervate keeper.
You can thank Blizzard for Boombox not hitting two up to 24.
All right, well, Phonetap is going to secure his first victory in this semifinal.
Good stuff.
Up 1-0.
I think this Paladin deck might actually struggle against the Hunter as well.
We've seen it do very well against Hunters in the past, though. But yeah, being this slow, it could have a little bit of trouble. But so far, I think it's like 2-0 against Hunters.
Handlock?
Handlock, it's got 100% win rate against.
It's like no way it loses to Handlock.
Yeah, no way it loses to Handlock. It's very, very good against Handlock.
I think if there's a deck that just beats Handlock every time, it's this one.
Yeah, Paladin, for sure.
Yeah.
But Phonetap, does he have a Handlock?
Oh, no, sorry. I just actually crossed it out and corrected my mistake.
Yeah, it's
Hunter. Hunter and the Mech Shaman.
Yeah, he's like the only remaining aggro player left.
I don't think Mech Shaman can really take on this Pally, though, because the Mech Shaman kind of works off just killing you exactly just in time.
Yeah.
And I feel like just going a little bit out of range is good enough.
But we saw that game, like, the Paladin could have slow starts and can't do anything until, like, Trusilver turn or Shredder turn, and just absolutely nothing before that. If that happens and the Mech Shaman has some of those mechs, gets a Whirling Zap-O-Matic down, he may be dead, like, turn four.
I mean, you could always draw your way out of that, but I feel like the Paladin just does really well against the Shaman.
All right. Yeah, it makes sense. It seems like he tried to gear it more towards anti-aggro while still making it beat Handlock.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, it is Paladin against Hunter.
All right. Well,
I'm not so sure about this. Like, I know he beat Hunter the first, his first round.
Yeah.
I don't remember the second one, how that went, but, I mean, he's here, so overall it went well.
Second round, in the quarterfinals, he didn't face a Hunter. He played against Domdus, who did not have a Hunter. So Domdus had Druid, Warlock, Warrior.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So it hasn't really been too tested against Hunter so far. Paladins in the tournament have a fantastic matchup against Hunter, as we talked about earlier.
Yeah, but this is a different Paladin.
Yeah, the monster for battle Paladin is just such a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Especially since most Hunters now are running only one Unleash. So monster for battle is really huge against Hunters.
Yeah. So Phonetap going with a little bit of a different strategy. Well, a lot of players debate whether or not it's best to keep your weakest deck until last to give you the most opportunities. He's the least confident in his mech shaman. So
seems about right.
Yeah. It's not a deck to be very confident in.
No.
So he wants to get a quick 2-0 and then move into mech shaman with three chances to win. So
yeah.
Not even a bad coin probably get that.
That's a decent curve for Phonetap. He's got he hits his first couple turns.
Double equality is not very good for the paladin.
No, it's not.
Yeah, one of the problems is that Hunter just has all of these death rattle minions, and equality only kills half of them. As they come back to
often
life.
The better half.
Yeah, the better half, but they're still annoying.
Yeah.
Lay on hands.
It's a little slow.
Card needed last turn. Last game.
Yeah.
Actually, well, it wouldn't have done that much.
Not
getting lay on hands into something good.
It would have, like, spent his whole turn, allowed Phonetap to just build something up again.
Phonetap would have had, like, one off lethal then.
Yeah, it's true.
Guardian of Kings, another slow card, not looking the greatest.
He, like, needs Phonetap to whiff.
I think you have to play something. You have to play Eldor, I feel.
No, you can't Eldor one of those. You have to save it for something bigger.
Good qualities.
You don't have the card draw to support just trying to keep up with tempo with them. You have to play the value game. So you have to use your life total as a resource and then catch back up later game with your heals. Mm-hmm. So, because the Heliodin, like, you're investing...
True sub of what?
Yeah, that's not very good. But you're investing your life total right now into card advantage, card quality, and then later game you catch back up on life with your heals.
Yeah. So Phonetap's decks are heavily teched against weapon classes. I believe he had Harrison Jones in his mid-range hunter. He had, like, Oozes in a couple of his
druid.
Decks.
Yeah,
in
druid.
His druid. So he might be able to get some value out of that.
Houndmaster number one coming down. He's also running double Houndmaster in his hunter.
Yeah.
So far, that's been quite good.
Yeah.
I think the only player who really struggled with Houndmaster was Kit Kat, who we thought had won.
Yeah.
Just happens that way sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so Eldor getting a little more value than before.
Yeah, but that's it.
Not much.
No.
For justice. This is sort of rough.
Yeah, it's really rough. He doesn't even have a play for next turn.
The bright side is he has the majority of his heals in his hand. He's got Seal of Light, Guardian of Kings, Lay on Hands.
Yeah, the thing is, like, during... Like, he's not stalling enough. Mm-hmm. So, like, you can't heal your way out of, like, a horrible board situation.
Yeah, exactly. He needs to have an equality combo first, and then you can heal your health. Yeah. So he needs to try and find a consecration or something. And the problem with Hunter sometimes is, even after your big board clear, they still have enough minions there to be too much of a threat to heal because of all the death rattles.
Well... His play next turn might be a 5-mana Aldor.
Yeah.
If it turns out that way.
And he might just kill it.
I don't know.
I don't think he's going to kill the Aldor. I don't know, though.
Because you kind of want to not have your high main get Aldored.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Can he afford to use something like Hunter's Mark, like Pot of Tread or Hunter's Mark?
Yeah, I think you actually can. You can afford to do that because the minion that you would then Hunter's Mark is going to be freezing trapped anyway.
Yeah.
So I like that. Yeah.
I like that a lot.
That's a really good line. Because now the next big minion that comes out, you're not going to want to Hunter's Mark kill it. You're just going to let it get freezing trapped.
Yeah.
So yeah, I would have liked to see that.
Okay.
We have the board clear.
Well, Phonetap doesn't push for damage and Demigod draws the pretty much exact card he needs to maybe come back this game.
Mm-hmm.
Phonetap hasn't applied too much damage.
I think a Wild Power may have been better.
Yeah, Wild Power Manager is the prime equality activator.
Yeah.
But he doesn't need to board clear just yet. But what do you do this turn then? Like, it looks like just Hero Power Pass. He doesn't really have any cards too playable in his hand. It's going to Seal of Light pop the Haunted Creeper. Justice.
I guess.
It's going to kind of signal the Phonetap that he's going for a board clear of some sort.
I think Phonetap is expecting a board clear just about every turn now.
Yeah.
All right, turn six. Here we go. Sven Highmane dropped onto the board. Well, he doesn't really have a way to deal. This is just such a tough board to deal with.
There we go. Dealt with.
Yeah, if it was that easy.
You know, sometimes it is just that easy.
Looks easy.
You take so much damage.
Yeah, there's 11 damage staring at you on board. If you take Dr. Boom, you're at 10, and that doesn't factor in the possibility of him just killing you. Like, kill command, quick shot, hero power, double
yeah,
kill
like,
command.
If you do quality consecrate, you're taking basically at least 6 anyway. So it's,
yeah.
You're taking another 5 to Dr. Boom. Seems okay.
Yeah. Guardian of Kings heals you, but it doesn't allow you to contest the board the following turn. So Dr. Boom seems like the most reasonable option.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess.
I guess. It.
I mean,
everything
all
feels
of them
bad.
Are bad, right? So yeah, you can't be too sure of yourself when everything's just.
He's almost dead, though. If the hunter went first, he would have killed him, because I think unleash, kill command, hero power was exactly.
Yeah, he doesn't. He's debating between Boom and going clear here. He's just really hoping for a Doomsayer off this Shredder.
Yeah.
Sheep day a
or
lot
something
better.
Very weak. One eye cheat!
That's a strong one.
That's not good for him.
No.
See, that's one of the worst!
Tenno was talking about. Like, what did he do there? He just prevented 3 damage.
Yeah, maybe it would have been better to play Guardian of Kings, because that prevents 6 damage and then lead into Tyrion, I guess.
Yeah. Alright, well now this board is starting to get a little bit out of control as well. He's piling on the damage.
It's okay, like, in my mind, he still has some outs here.
Does he? Of.
Yeah, if he can clear his board with like a Pyromancer and then heal the turn after that, maybe.
Yeah. Shielded Minibot is not going to do it.
No, that's it.
Does Tyrion save him?
No.
He's got
Hunter's Mark, so he could just...
Yeah. Not even close.
Throw
yeah,
in anything.
Not even close.
Yeah. So much overkill. Lay on Hands only brings him up to 17.
Yeah, there's nothing he can do.
There's 14 damage on the board, 16 with hero power. You just need to have 1 damage.
Man, we kind of overhyped this Paladin deck. Doesn't seem so good.
Yeah.
What?
I don't know. You were the one talking about it. The Paladin win rate is so good, remember?
Excluding this one.
Excluding this game, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, what are you guys talking about? Paladin's the worst.
Wow. You changed your mind really quick.
I think you're just not remembering it correctly.
Oh, okay.
All right, so Lay on Hands means
King of Lay on Hands is
he's
the best
thinking
play.
He's not...
Lay on Hands absorbs the same amount of damage as Tyrion, and he needs a combo piece for equality for him to have any chance. So this is the correct play, but it's all irrelevant.
He's got the combo piece for equality.
He would have needed exactly Pyromancer Healbot in that array.
Yes.
Yeah.
That would have been pretty good.
All right, well...
Yeah, if he lived.
Yep.
Phonetap is going to take a very quick 2-0 lead. All he needs to do is win 1 game out of 3 with Mech Shaman in order to secure a spot in the final.
So it's still anybody's game.
Yeah.
Phonetap's definitely
what
favorite.
What does Demigod have? He's got this Paladin deck, which I think...
Dragon Warrior.
I'm actually pretty confident this can beat the Shaman.
Okay.
The Dragon Warrior... I don't know.
If it has Fiery War X on 2, then I think it can beat the Mech Shaman.
Okay. And then Freeze Mage.
Freeze Mage can beat the Mech Shaman, I'm pretty sure. Especially with 2 Kona Colds. The Kona Colds are going to be pretty helpful.
That's one that you'd know the best. I don't even know how that works.
Well, I don't know. You have to use your resources really, really quickly. And a lot of times you don't have too much time to draw. But it basically comes down to, do they have Whirling Zap-O-Matic? And can I kill Whirling Zap-O-Matic? Because if they have it...
Yeah, you can ping it. And then the trap, you ping it again.
Yeah, you're dead.
Unless you
damn.
Ping it over
but it
two
works
turns.
All the time in Arena.
Yeah.
No, yeah. You're going to want that Frostbolt on 2 every single time.
Yeah.
Live by the light, die by the light.
Yeah. And getting a Doomsayer off early is really good. Sometimes just playing Doomsayer on 2 against Mech Shaman is really good.
Just to stall them, get that extra mana crystal.
Yeah.
And Fellreaver, if it's played, sometimes you can like just burn their whole deck.
Yeah, just keep freezing that over and over and over again.
Because you're freezing anyway, because they're playing creatures.
I have to see that.
You're not like sacrificing anything to freeze it, because whether or not that was something else, like if that was like a spider tank, you would still be freezing turn after turn. So you're sort of inadvertently just burning through their whole deck, which is...
And Demigod's deck is more freeze than most freeze mage.
But one of the other concerns, Mech Shaman can also get Ragnaros on turn 8 if they run Ragnaros.
Yeah, that's true. He does run Rag.
That's really rough for Freeze Mage to deal with. So.
Yeah. All right, well, this matchup is going to be Paladin versus the Mech Shaman. Demigod, once again, Gonna throw out the Paladin.
Yeah. Shield of Minibot's one of those cards that's basically invincible. Oh. Except when your opponent plays a 2-3.
That's Zombie Chow.
Zombie Chow, though.
Yeah.
Zombie Chow and Shield of Minibot.
Into Aldor? Oh my goodness.
The Paladin finally getting the start it needs to fight off aggro.
Yeah, but yeah, this is like an amazing start for Shaman, too.
Yeah, it's not bad.
No, I think Shaman's gonna win this early game brawl.
Really? Yeah, I mean, if he gets the Yeti down next turn, for sure.
Well, what would stop him?
Nothing.
Nothing.
Yeah, so the Shaman's doing pretty well.
The Shaman's doing really well, but the Yeti is going to be met with the Aldor Peacekeeper on curve.
Yeah, so just the draw here is really important. The Shaman needs like a card or two here just to play stuff, and that Spider Tank's good enough. It would have been kind of a shame to see like double Lava Burst or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But short of that, I think the Shaman is doing extremely well.
Yeah, the Shaman's doing really good.
He's thinking whether or not he wants to try and take out the shielded mini-bot here with Urshock and play Spider Tank, playing Mechanical Yeti.
I don't think he's thinking that. I think it's just Yeti.
Yeah.
Well, he paused, so he was thinking.
He's thinking about something.
Yeah. And that's the only thing he could be thinking about.
No, he could be thinking about what he wants for dinner.
That's true.
A lot of options in LA. A lot of options.
All right. I would like to see Yeti and then just go face. Save the Urshock to maybe get through a taunt.
Yeah.
Or get rid of the Aldor's effect, even. And you have a lot of 2-drops in your deck, so next turn you could potentially play Spider Tank with something else.
Even just weaving in Hero Power, if nothing else happens.
Yeah, exactly.
Taunt
Totem is
really good.
Really good. All the time.
All of the time.
All right, well, I guess we can think about something here, but what are we going to think about? Are we going to think about Peacekeeping or Peacekeeping?
He could coin Piloted Shredder, but that's just really bad.
Mm-hmm.
Is it?
It doesn't really contest.
Yeah, it doesn't trade
up
with
the Yeti. It kind of plays into a follow-up Consecrate. It's not terrible.
I could see that.
Yeah.
Like, if you play the Shredder, the Shaman's going to go face, so you just pretend like you have control.
Yeah.
So the Shredder goes into the Yeti, the 2-2 goes into the 2-3, and maybe Consecrate picks up something.
Peacekeeper is also one of the best things to do against Fellweaver.
Mm-hmm. Right now in your hand, the only activator for a quality you have is that Consecrate, so are you willing to throw that away then?
Yeah.
For some weird play? I mean, why not just play on curve?
Yeah, okay. I just think it's actually an option.
It's an option, but yeah. Is it better?
I don't know.
Good old casting with Crypt.
Crypt is here to prod your brain. Like, just poke the inside of your head.
Yeah.
That seems weird. That seems also weird.
There you go. Yeah. I like that one. Well, you could play all the minions and then go face.
Yeah.
Yep. I agree.
But he has the opportunity to use the Earthshock to swing for 4 instead of 1. But that does make his minion vulnerable to True Silver Champion.
Also means he doesn't have any way to get through Belcher or Tyrion later on in the game.
Yeah.
He also starts to get kind of wrecked by Consecrate.
Yeah, Consecrate becomes a real factor. The Totem.
Nah. Think it would have Urshocked if you rolled spell power?
Yeah, probably. Did Urshock and play Cogmaster?
Even this doesn't seem so great.
Yeah, slowly starting to slip into Paladin favor, maybe.
I mean, they have the same amount of life somehow.
Yeah. That's not a good position for my Shaman.
Yeah.
And there's chances for Phonetap to like draw into his bigger drops like Dr. Boom and Ragnaros, but there's a lot of heal sort of in the interim. So he has to like apply pressure and then draw into his big drops right away.
That's good.
Yeah.
Yeah. And just pick off that spider tank.
I think you actually kill the Mech Warper. Slow things down.
Well, I guess you know he probably doesn't have any mechs in his hand, but yeah, I would have liked killing the Mech Warper as well.
And 5 mana doesn't reduce any. I mean, unless he had multiple mechs.
Well, this is going to turn out better for him.
Stoneclaw Totem. Always good.
Consecrate.
I think you Rockbiter here to protect your totem. and Challenge of True Silver.
Yeah. And this Consecrate is going to be painful.
Yeah. And with the Consecrate, the Paladin is ahead in the face game.
Which is not where you want to be as the Shaman.
Yeah, definitely not.
He's pretty much out of cards. I mean, he has a Dr. Boom and an Earthshot. Next turn, he could realistically be only Hero Power.
We get the coin Hero Power in. I guess that coin wasn't really accomplishing anything with the current hand anyway. Just having something on the board in case they play something big. To use a quality with while developing a 4-drop is pretty good.
Power Mace is something to do. It also has the potential to buff up a Boom Bot.
Kind of like the face hit. The 1-1 does nothing.
Yeah. Well, it kills the Stone Claw Totem over 2 turns.
That's fine.
Apparently, it's not fine for him.
Okay.
I feel like he's just going to run out of damage, especially with how many heals. He's not going to be able to play like a grindy game. I don't know if he has the ability
to be able to. We'll just have to see how much impact Dr. Boom has. Sometimes Dr. Boom is just a measly 7 mana, 9-9, does 2 damage to nothing.
Oh, measly?
Yes.
Okay.
But other times, you play him and you do 15 damage as you choose among 2 different 4 health creatures.
It's pretty good when it does that.
Yes, it is pretty strong.
All right, so... Well, the Stone Clock Totem can tank the Shredder hit, so maybe you don't even bother trading with it, just swing face.
He killed the dude last turn. That doesn't seem very consistent.
Yeah.
So you think he's going to kill the dude again?
I think he's going to kill the...
The Shredder?
I think it doesn't matter.
Is there any merit to holding?
I think it just totally doesn't matter. Like, losing equality, whatever.
What to do?
Yeah. Well, if he kills the dude... Yeah, equality still kills Dr. Boom. So there's no way to play around equality at all here.
No.
That's unfortunate. So he's just going to swing face.
Whatever. It's fine. It's just not consistent his last turn, but it's fine.
Kirby seemed a little irked.
Am I irked? What is irked?
Irked?
Yeah.
Bothered?
No, I'm okay.
Okay.
He's got a pretty sick turn lined up with equality into Sludge Belcher. Not only does he get to kill the Dr. Boom, he gets to put up a taunt.
Mm-hmm.
True Silver down the 3-3 Boom Bot, probably.
Just feel like Phonetap is slowly being pushed out of this game.
Yeah.
His hand is effectively just a Crackle and an Earthshock.
Yeah, it's not a really good hand.
He can get through a taunt. Maybe if he draws, like...
I don't even know
what he could draw.
I think it's okay to take 3 damage here.
Yeah. Get a pretty respectable life total.
And I think the Acolyte might do a pretty good job of absorbing this bomb.
Wow, that's the greedy play.
Yep.
Oh, hello.
Right to the ace.
Still keeping the life totals even with the Bluegill Warrior.
Yep.
Making sure he stays in there. Oh, no.
Second Earthshock is not what you want to see.
Phonetap's like, all right, we're going to have to combo a few spells to get rid of this creature.
These would be the kinds of draws that you would want if the board that you had early on
stuck. Well, actually, that Boom Bot might do something here.
It could kill the Belcher.
It could.
And the other creature.
Yeah, both of them.
It seems fine for half the battle cry of a 7-drop at the 7-7.
Yeah, it's pretty good. Instead, we're going to push for face damage. He needs to make up damage somewhere, and this 1-1 is what's going to do it for him.
Well, we go back to that turn where he used the Power Mace on a 1-1. And you think...
Well, he's making up that ground now.
Yeah.
It's 3 more hits.
And now he's going to get punished even more for not trading in because...
He's got this magical Earth Shot.
Yeah,
it's getting double value, too. It's beating the spare part and the Acolyte's natural draw effect.
That's true.
I guess you gotta find 2-for-1 somewhere.
It's getting value. Well, might as well crackle face while you have the spell power.
6! Almost the best!
If he gets a Ragnaros...
Demigod's like, are you serious? He didn't even care that's a spare part. It should be a card. Doesn't matter what card it was.
Yeah. Lay on hands pretty much going to seal out this game.
Yeah. Even if he didn't, I don't know if there'd be a two-card combination that would kill him. If he rolled Spell Power and had something like Spell Power double Lava Burst, he could.
It'd have to be, I think, a Doomhammer and something else silly right after that. Well, that was pretty silly pump hit.
Yeah.
Oh, Harrison Jones.
Well, he's got two turns to try and figure out a way to kill him.
I just don't think it's going to happen. With Harrison Jones as well, Aldor Peacekeeper for a Fel Reaver, he's got answers to just about everything that can be thrown out.
Yeah, it looks pretty unlosable from the Paladin side. So the Paladin's going to get its first win after losing two games this series. And maybe Demigods, this is the start of the reverse sweep.
We talked about
against
it earlier.
Against Shaman, we have seen exactly this.
Yes, yes.
We've seen, I think Kabi was up 2-0,
mm-hmm.
and then Shaman was left.
And
then at
happened.
The end of the series, it was still left.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just so inconsistent with the draws, and your opponent can shut down things that you do so quickly.
Yeah.
If they do have a way to deal with the Whirling Zap-O-Matic, if they do have a way to deal with the Mech Warper shenanigans early on.
Yeah, Demigod's lineup is really good against this Shaman. Like, which deck is maybe the weakest against the Shaman, do you think?
So he has maybe Dragon Warrior, because you can
yeah,
get copies
yeah,
a lot
Dragon
of big,
Warrior,
big
yeah.
drops in the early hand. All right, there's the concede.
Yeah, it's running like so many 9 drops and 8
yeah.
drops, and you can definitely get a bogged down hand.
Demigod mounts his comeback, 2-1. He's down.
Yeah, I think the Freeze Mage is much more consistent than the Warrior.
Yeah, I would have to agree.
Yeah, like the Warrior has a few options early on, but Freeze Mage has quite a few. I think even against the Whirling Zap-O-Matic, even if you let it loose for a turn, you can still win.
But he's running one Ice Barrier, so that's something to consider as well.
Yeah.
So off of his first Scientist, generally
but
you always want to get Ice Barrier.
He made up with the Healbot, and the Healbot is better against spells, which is usually what the Shaman does once he's getting Chain Frozen. So
sure.
Is that really that bad?
It's kind of a big deal when you think about the Scientist interaction,
yeah.
though, because your
less
chance to
chance.
Get one of the 8 mm. heals is way less because you don't have those things that just search out and draw it.
You can
yeah.
play it for free from a 2-2 as opposed to playing it for 5 mana and just getting a 3-3.
I just feel the way the deck naturally plays out, it makes late game Ice Barrier totally useless.
Yeah.
Yeah, late game Ice Barrier is pretty useless against it. But the first Ice Barrier,
yeah.
that's the really important part.
Yeah.
It makes it so they don't really get to that state as quickly.
Well, to get to that stage, he's going to have to win with Warrior.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. Phonetap's been talking about he doesn't think he'll ever get used to the nerves of playing in a booth on a big stage like this.
Well,
Demigod looks pretty used to.
Yeah.
He just
looks like
comfy.
He's in a tavern. Like, he's got the barrel beside him. He's looking at it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Ready.
Ready.
I mean, Phonetap doesn't look that nervous, but he says he's nervous, right?
He's getting more comfortable as the day goes on. Like, every single match, it looks like he looks more relaxed.
I think Demigod's playing tic-tac-toe there.
For Doomhammer. Whoa! Double Fel Reaver.
Double Fel Reaver. Okay, well, let's see what he gets.
See if Demigod maybe keeps the Big Game Hunter just in case.
Oh, that might be a Freeze Mage game, if nothing follows that Cogmaster.
Yeah, he's going to need to find one of the two drops. The deck has a lot of two drops, though. So that's usually the point where you pretty
it's okay.
consistent
you
on getting
go
something.
For it.
Yeah.
But against Warrior, I feel like you sort of have to have a really great start.
Oh, he kept the Big Game Hunter, and the Fel Reaver is drawn.
Seen 3 Fel Reavers so far.
Yeah.
That's pretty funny.
All right, well, series is tied up.
Yeah. You can't call it just yet.
Yeah, but I know. No Fiery War Axe, that's one thing that he could be happy about.
Wow.
Yeah, no 2-drop is huge. The deck runs so many 2-drops, it's very often that you have a 2-drop. The 1-drop's usually the hard part.
Mm-hmm. Now if he doesn't draw a mech here, the Cool Taskmaster is just going to eat up the Cogmaster as well.
Well, there's also some options with the Totem if a mech is not drawn.
Oh my god.
Other Fel Reaver.
Okay.
4 Fel Reavers have been seen this game.
That's unbelievable.
He's going to be having nightmares about Fel Reavers.
Up until this point in,
we haven't
in
seen
this
a
tournament, we didn't
like
know there was 2 in the deck.
Yeah, we haven't even seen him
now
drawn.
We are sure.
Yeah. Very sure.
Yeah.
Oh, he's a little bit of a misplay here if he decides to play the armor spit now.
It's
missing
a BM play.
One armor.
It's okay.
Demigod looks kind of bored.
Mech Shaman again.
Yeah.
Can they just give me the win?
Right. Yeah, this Mech Shaman hand has not been good at all.
Yeah. We have to be fair. For every Mech Shaman game where you get this dud, there's the Mech Shaman games where you win on turn 5 with Whirling Zap-O-Matic, double Rockbiter.
Yeah, definitely.
I really like the Deathbite.
Yeah, Deathbite, just getting it up seems really good.
Maybe he wants to Shield Slam the 1-2.
Strike!
Or try and cycle into his dragons a little bit quicker to activate the Blackwing Corruptor.
Yeah, if he wants the Blackwing Corruptor next turn. And this is going to be a sad Felreaver, as it is going to be met by the Big Game Hunter.
He still has the coin. Let's just keep that in mind. We have coin, Shield Slam, Armor Up. Oh, no, you have to play. You have to play. It's like, it's just so much fun.
You have to mill cards.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sometimes you lose when you do that.
Yeah.
But it's so much fun.
The cards milled don't matter until you're out of cards.
Mm-hmm.
So unless he knows that he's going to be able to mill him enough to where he runs out of cards by the end of the match,
At the very least, you coin an Acolyte.
Yeah, it looks like he's going to start off with Acolyte.
Yeah.
It
can give you some more information, is the thing. Like, not seeing the Rockbiter burn can give you information
fun as well.
Yeah, Lothab gone.
Mech Warper. Earthshock.
Right. Both Shredders was pretty impactful, but the other set of cards wasn't as meaningful.
Crackle.
Dr.
Boom!
That's a big one.
Yeah. The big threats are what he really wanted to not see burn.
Mm-hmm. Alright. And Felreaver number 2.
And Rockbiter. I think the Cog.
I mean,
Cog.
It's a pretty good Fire Elemental turn as well.
Cogmaster. I always screw that up. I think it's a Cogmaster, but it might be a Cogmaster.
It's Cogmaster.
It's Cogmaster.
Yeah.
Cogmaster.
Nailed it.
Cogsmith would have been a fantastic name, though, Crip.
Yeah, thank you.
To be fair.
I think that's got to go into the Acolyte, because you don't want to give the Warrior cards as much as you want to go face the Warriors over the base health pool.
Mm-hmm.
I think you need to do some damage control a little bit.
Yeah.
Sure.
And I think the Rockbiter on the big game is also fair.
Mm-hmm. Just to reduce the options to trade into the 8-8.
And then you're going to lose all your deck and your Felreaver to Shield Slam.
Yeah. Wow. You're hoping he doesn't have it. That's the dream. They don't have any removal for it, and you just get to whack him with an 8-8 a few times.
I think maybe you might even save your hope for the game against the Mage at this point.
Or just concede?
Yeah, just be like, I hope I get as unlucky as possible just to save the good luck for the last game.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, in that case, you'd want to stay in this game as long as possible. Maybe see what that Felreaver is going to discard.
Okay.
But yeah.
He's leaning towards Fire Elemental.
Yeah. The way this game is going, it looks like it is going to go to Game 5, though, because...
No, this is okay. Yeah. I think the Fire Elemental is way better than the Felreaver, because it just doesn't get wrecked.
Yeah, and it can bait out some removal that maybe would have taken care of the Felreaver, like this Shield Slam we might see here. Yeah, it's looking like it could be a Shield Slam Belcher turn.
Looks good, though.
Yeah, that's a really good turn from the Warrior.
Yeah.
Like, even though now he doesn't really have an answer to kill the Felreaver...
He doesn't have a creature besides the Felreaver.
Yeah,
he's
pretty committed.
Two Power Maces.
Yeah.
That's horrible.
Yeah, that's not good.
I kind of like players getting crushed in tournaments. I don't care who they are. Like, you guys thought I just want to see Reyna get crushed. It just so happened he was about to play.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But I actually feel a little bit bad for Phonetap. Like... He is getting really wrecked right now playing this Shaman.
This Shaman's not looking pretty.
But you're sure this is a good deck?
I didn't say it was consistent.
Okay.
I said it was strong.
Okay.
There's a big distinction there.
Okay.
Personally, I've won a tournament or two with Mech Shaman, but it was a lot better when nobody knew what was going on.
Yeah. Felreaver, what does that even do?
Yeah, when everyone had to stop and read Felreaver, you knew you were in a good spot.
Yeah. Yeah. Emperor Thor's in as well, just gonna reduce the. He's at 35 health.
Yeah, that's a pretty good spot against Mech Shaman.
With initiative on board, it's just Phonetap in the first matchup. He had a good curve, but Paladin had answers. Now this matchup, he didn't have the curve, but it didn't matter because Demigod had answers anyway.
Yeah. I think if you're going to play the Felreaver, you want to buff the Spider Tank.
Isn't he going to Lava Burst? No, he's just going to leave the Emperor. Of course, all face.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, goodbye, deck.
Yeah. You put a lot of eggs in one basket here, too, by not buffing the spider tank.
He can draw, play a weapon, attack and draw something else.
Yeah, he can mill. Can he mill every card? How many cards are left?
Has to be close to it.
Yeah.
I don't like that.
You want to mill every card?
Yes.
Yes.
Well, I think he's still...
No, you could have played another one with the Death Spite into Fiery War Axe into Execute.
Yeah.
I mean, why do you need weapons if he has no cards?
Oh, no.
Oh, you still mill every card.
Every wow. single card.
Yeah, every single card still this way.
All right, well, we can do some quick math here. There's Lava Burst, which is 5, and then Power Message, which is 6.
I think he's dead.
Yeah. That one, don't one, think that's
that
enough.
That one totem has to do a lot of damage.
Yeah. I don't think it's going to cut it.
No. Well, I think we've completely sterilized the ladder of Mech Shaman for a while.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're going to watch this, and they're going to be like, no.
Thousands of players simultaneously across the world just went in their collection and deleted their Mech Shaman deck.
Yeah.
Yeah, phone tap scene was going on.
Yeah.
Probably blames you for some of this. It's like, I saw Firebat in that one tournament.
Alrighty, well, we are going to a game number 5. Demigod is going to tie it up 2-2.
Yeah. That was the tricky one.
Yeah.
And he's able to get that out of the way just because Phonetap's. He never drew any of the 2-drops at all.
Yeah.
Like.
Yeah, very, very. Like, we don't have to say those bad draws. Everyone watching knows
they're
horrifying. Absolutely horrifying draws.
Yeah. Feel bad.
Yeah. Feel a little bit bad too.
So the final matchup is going to be Mech Shaman from Phonetap versus Freeze Mage from Demigod.
Mech Shaman can still win it.
Yeah. Sometimes just too fast.
Too fast, yeah.
Yeah.
Not with those draws, though.
Yeah, he needs the coin-whirling Zap-O-Matic into Freeze Mage, have only things that cost 3+, into the other whirling Zap-O-Matic, into like Flame Tongue Totem and Rockbiter sort of thing going on.
Do you have Flame Tongue?
I don't think so. I think he's running the 2 Earthshock version, which cut the 1 Flame Tongue, I think.
Yeah.
We haven't seen Flame Tongue, and I'm pretty sure we just saw 30 cards.
Yep. So there's no Flame Tongue.
No Flame Tongue.
No Flame Tongue.
Good. We got that settled.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fun deck, though. I mean, I've certainly seen a lot of play from it. It doesn't usually play out like this.
Mm-hmm.
Even when it loses, it tends to do better.
Yeah. Tends to usually have some sort of a chance.
Yeah.
It just takes it to race mode and then keeps piling on damage.
And there's actually usually some strategy to whether you go face or clear some minions some of the time.
Yeah.
But when you get wrecked this hard on draws, there's not much of anything.
You really couldn't do anything about it.
Yeah.
But.
All right. So looking at these players, Phonetap, he's been a little bit stressed.
Demigod looks just the same as when he was 0-2.
Yeah. Yeah. He's a calm guy. Talking to him throughout the studios, he's just really happy to be here, really happy to play. He's super relaxed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He does seem super relaxed.
Yeah. To put the stakes on the line here, the loser of this next game is out of the tournament. To come this far to the semifinals, even for the open players, it's great that they make it to the semifinals. But in the back of their minds, they're thinking after that quarterfinal, they have victory in their sights. So It's got to be tough, but the winner does move on to the semifinals to play.
Oh, we see
there
our
it
good
is.
Hand. There it is.
Oh, my.
And we see Demigod going with the full mulligan, looking for something to deal with it. And that's a trash hand. This could be what Phonetap needs to win the series. Oh, no help. Are we going to see the aggressive start going with Whirling Zap-O-Matic first?
God, this
shot
is so dumb.
There it is. Does he have the answer? Frostbolt off the top. Will it happen?
And Doomsayer is not good enough.
Doomsayer.
Oh, there it is. That's actually Doomsayer.
You have to play it.
Yeah, you have to play it. You have to just try.
Oh, no.
All right, so maybe...
It still absorbs 7, which is fine.
Just cash in the Rockbiter.
I'd say that's pretty good for 2
pretty
cards.
Good. Yeah. Sorry, you had about half health. So Arcane Intellect.
These draws are going to be huge. Frost Nova. Whew, you got to freeze.
Okay.
Wow. And now we can expect Phonetap to draw terrible cards.
Mechanical Yeti fits the curve pretty nicely.
Yeah, it's really good.
Yeah.
If Thalnos comes down, though, Fireball is going to be able to deal enough damage to kill the Mechanical Yeti.
Yeah. Archmage Antonitis, that's not really going to help.
So if he wants to preserve his Mechanical Yeti against Fireball, he has to trade here with the the Power Mace.
I mean, he was killing dudes two turns ago,
yeah.
So I think that's decent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's an opportunity for him to maybe
play two minions?
Yeah. Mech Warper and Noyotron. Doesn't put as much power
really
on the board.
Main problem that I see is with this pressure hand, it's going to be really hard to develop some of the big stuff that you need to win.
Yeah.
Like, Ice Flux not going to be played for a while, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that Dr. Boom coming down on 7 is going to be really strong, as well as the Fel Reaver. Like, it just forces the Freeze Mage to freeze every turn. Like, yeah. Sure, you're milling cards, but you have to use all of your cards so inefficiently. And he is going to play around the Fireball by killing the Blood Mage Thalnos here.
Well, it's a Boulder Fist Ogre.
Yeah. A mechanical Boulder Fist Ogre.
Yeah.
With a Death Rattle.
He just gave Blizzard a new card idea.
So I guess
I would like that if it was a dragon.
A mechanical Boulder Fist Ogre Dragon.
Yes. We have enough overpowered mechs.
I wonder.
As Demigod here, I guess you just have to ice block our ice barrier and then ping and set up the fireball down the Yeti.
Mm-hmm.
You want to get the barrier out before you have to block, just to get your life total a bit higher so that you can't potentially be burst down.
Yep.
You're just so behind if you do that. Like, you can't even fireball that if Fel Reaver comes down.
Yeah, but that's, you just gotta hope Mech Shaman doesn't have the good draw. And that's like all you can do, right?
Yeah.
Because what else are you doing that turn? Like, you can't just draw off Acolyte. So he's thinking in his head, hopefully there's no Fel Reaver.
Yeah.
Actually, if he doesn't Fel Reaver,
is it better?
It might be, because he can do Mech Warper Paladin Treader, and next turn he can do a Noyotron Fel Reaver.
And also,
assuming the Mech Warper is still alive.
Does the last game play into his head at all? He's thinking, I kissed my deck goodbye last game.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, here it comes. It's going to be met by Frost Nova, and a lot of cards milled. Doomsayer off the top would be huge.
Or second freeze. Frost Nova.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, Frost Nova Acolyte of Pain into another Frost Nova.
What'd you say last game, Crip? Say goodbye to your deck?
Yep. Wow. He can afford to lose those.
I think he just doesn't want to see burn.
Crackle.
Ooh, Rockbiter, that one hurts. Was he running a Doomhammer?
Yes.
Don't think we saw it. Oh, we did?
Yeah, we did.
We saw it. It was from the deck, and then...
Yeah. Well, Fire Elemental
off the top is really good.
Yeah. Allows him to deny draws from the Acolyte of Pain without having to use some type of burn spell. Or you could hit him in the face!
It's actually pretty tricky.
Fireball, you're onto something!
I think I actually prefer the face hit.
Oh, yeah? Why is that?
Damage.
I thought you were going to have some more of an explanation to play around some cards or something. But yeah, I think
from my understanding, this is not the type of deck that plays around cards.
Yeah,
all right.
Yeah. I don't think...
Smoke him down.
One of the things I think is, I don't think the mage has time to really ping the Acolyte. Like...
That's true. Very true.
It always feels... No, then he goes and pings it, but it's unoptimal for him to be drawing here, because the game's going to be over in a few turns. That's why you play a Fel Reaver.
Oh, Kona Cold, though.
Lining up more
freezes. That's really good.
Yeah.
Oh no! That would have been so good.
Doomhammer's gone.
Crackle.
Whoa. Doomhammer and Crackle, both huge cards.
Even the Fel Reaver.
Yeah.
He needs Earthshock. To Earthshock his Fel Reaver, not only to preserve his cards,
but hit in face for 8.
But hit face for 8. That would have been probably the best draw on his deck.
I think Dr. Boom is a card you might want to save. If you can do enough damage to the mage and he does a Doomsayer Freeze combo, you can win off the bombs.
Potentially.
And I think you have a big enough board already.
Yeah.
So I think Dr. Boom's actually kind of bad.
Yeah. I agree.
Mm-hmm.
And it also gives him free draw off Acolyte.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what do you do then? Is it just like a Shredder Totem?
I think you Totem. If you get a 1-1, you just do Mech Warper Shredder. And if you don't get a 1-1, then you just Shredder.
Okay.
Or you can Cogmaster if you want.
He's going to... Nope. He's thinking about it.
Yeah, I think he's thinking about the same thing. I think he realizes that opportunity. Like, how do I lose this game? This way. Do I choose to play around that? Well, it is Shop. It is Mech Shop. So maybe not.
Yeah, maybe not.
I think Dr. Moon is the most standard play, and usually when you run out of time, yeah. I've seen players, you tend to make the standard play.
Yeah. Then again, Dr. Boom, I mean, it puts the most power on the board now. Those Boom Bots still have the potential to do a lot of damage. Flame Strike!
Yes, but there's some cards we have yet to mill.
Oh, yes!
Yeah, and you can't really set up a clear here too well.
I'm surprised to see that ping. I thought I'd just run that into a bomb.
Yeah, I thought so as well.
Alright, once again, Phonetap's gonna hold his breath and hope that he has stuff left in his deck to be able to kill Demigod after this turn.
He's gonna start for an Alistraz play. What was that? I missed it.
Earthshock.
Earthshock's gone.
Is it gone, or is that the first?
And that was the first.
That was the first.
Well, but
probably see pretty soon.
He's running out of cards. What is he milled? 18 now?
Oh, Crackle's gone.
Spider Tank.
Lava Burst gone.
All those are great.
Yeah. He still has the Earthshock left, though, right?
Lothib is huge.
Wow.
That's going to seal him out of the game, pretty much.
Yeah, but if he Lothibs, he has Ice Block activated. Lothib will buy him one turn. He can pop the block the following turn, but then he has to find a way.
So he... All right,
no,
so
you
Lothib's,
do not Lothib here.
Well, Alex comes down if you do.
Yeah, which is not good.
Well, then your opponent needs the second block. How many cards in is he? Like, what is the chances he has the second block plus enough burn to kill you? That's what you got to be thinking about. Because you could Lothib
or
here.
Enough burn to kill you.
Yeah, it's one or the other.
Oh, one or the...
Yeah. He'd have one turn. So
that,
if he,
the sum of that isn't that unlikely.
Yeah, the sum of that isn't that unlikely. I think it's more likely than not.
But do you have any other choice?
Yeah. I mean, you could just pass. Your board's still alive. He needs to freeze it again.
You pass, but then your deck's... Your board's gone. Most likely.
How? What is going to kill all of this stuff? Flamestrike doesn't do anything to this.
Yeah.
He's only got one freeze left, and that's the one Blizzard. I don't like playing the Shredder, though, because if you develop...
He does have second Kona Cold, but Dr. Boom makes that really problematic.
Oh, Flamestrike does okay.
Well, there's still going to be...
Also, he's got 9 mana to mill the rest of your deck.
Yeah, there's going to be 15 damage on the board, which
but
is enough to pop.
If you get, like, a freeze spare part, it's suddenly okay.
Okay. I can see that.
Or Frostbolt.
All right, so he's going to play another minion, so...
Wow.
Now Lothib seals the game.
Yeah, Lothib seals the game.
He has the actually top deck ice block.
Whoa. Earthshock's gone. Rag is gone. He's
always in fatigue, though.
But whoa.
Yeah, fatigue's not going to be enough, though. He can't kill him through Lothib. Wait, can he? He can pop him in and kill Alex, right?
That's the question. Mm-hmm. Can he?
I think so.
He has to be able to.
He's got a lot of damage.
This is...
Yeah.
Yeah, there's no way he can't.
Yeah, there's no way.
This is close to, like, 100 damage.
Yeah, that's a lot.
Somewhere in between 10 and 100.
Holding back on that Lothib was really, really key.
Yeah.
A lot of players, like, they get in that situation, and they think, oh my god, I got Lothib, I win.
Yeah.
And that would have lost him the game to play it there.
Right.
Potentially.
No. Absolutely.
Absolutely, yeah.
Absolutely lost him the game.
Well, he doesn't have the cards in his hand to win with it yet.
Yeah, he would have...
Well, no, if he Lothib that turn, he would have Alistrazed anyway, and then he didn't have Lothib, so he died at double Fireball, which he does have.
Yeah, which he would have top deck, yeah.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
So he would have absolutely lost that. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it's good play by Phonetap.
Yeah.
You want to leave the Boombot up in case he has to AoE next turn.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So that way, if it hits base... All right, here we go. Lothib's on the board. What can Demigod do?
Top deck Ice Block is the only thing.
Yeah.
Nope.
That doesn't
not
do
gonna
it.
Do it.
Wait, no. Oh, he did play 2 Frost Novas.
Yeah, 2 Frost Novas.
I don't think he has anything.
Yeah, he can't. If he Loot Hoarders and pings the Loot Hoarder...
That's game.
That's game because he won't have enough mana. He can't. He has no way to kill his own mad scientist because he needs 11 mana to do it.
Yeah, he had 3 outs there since he has the scientist in hand. He had 2 Frostbolts and the ice.
No, he can't even like fireball his own mad scientist.
Yeah,
well,
yeah.
He would have been able to Frostbolt
if he
top decked
the Frostbolt. So he had 3 outs out of like what, 12, 15 cards, something like that.
Wow. No, less than 15 cards.
Yeah, I have no idea how many though.
It's probably about 10, I'd say.
10 cards?
Yeah, I think so.
So he had like 33% or so.
I think that's it. It's got to be it. He's going to try and draw with his Loot Hoarder, but there's nothing he can get.
Oh, one card off the Frostbolt, which would have saved him and allowed him to win the game next turn.
Phonetap knows. He's pumping his fist. He knows it's six mana. There's nothing that's keeping Demigod in this game.
One card away.
Yep.
Wait, he could have played the Scientist and pinged the Boombot.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
He missed that opportunity. That could have made him live. Leaving the Boombot up could have been...
it is a misplay, because nothing else could have done anything.
Yeah, nothing else could have won him the game.
The
so
only way he's going to win the game is leave the Boombot up, which Phonetap did, which is actually a bad play now that I think about
it. Yeah, leaving the Boombot up.
It took us like 4 minutes to think about it. So
we'll let him slide comes out. Phonetap is the first player to move on to the finals.
Wow. What a game.
That was intense.
That was. I kind of worry for this Shaman deck, though. I feel like pulling a win barely here
with that draw
might not continue to happen in the next few matches.
Yeah. Mech Shaman's...
No, next match. He's only got to go through one more opponent.
Yeah, one more opponent.
There's Kabi giving him a hug. Those guys, Kabi, when he won, he accredited a lot of his victory to Phonetap. Phonetap is a guy that helps as many players as he can. He's in a bunch of practice groups. A lot of players say Phonetap is the guy that is the go-to guy when they need help because he's always willing to help anybody no matter what the circumstance.
Awesome.
Good stuff.
I'm sure now he's going to receive a lot of friend invites from everybody everywhere now that you promoted that.
Hey, Phonetap, you want to look at my
so
deck here?
More so if he wins.
Yeah, more so if he wins.
Yeah. Yeah, crowd clapping as Phonetap makes his way to the stage from the player booth.
Yeah, I mean, the Mech Shaman is just like the weirdest thing. You know, he got totally slammed by his deck in the first two tries.
Yeah.
And the third one, still very, very close.
Yeah, even with good draws.
Yeah.
Yeah. The Freeze Mage just had all of the freezes. Like, he had the cone and then into the double Frost Nova. Like,
what was the chance if Demigod made the only play that he could have won with? What was the chance of that happening? It was a 50-50 and then it had to
and
roll.
And then a 50-50.
More than zero. No, it's 2, 3, or 4. Yeah, so it's 75%.
Oh, 75%. Yeah, 2 works too.
Yeah, that's not too bad. That's 37.5%.
Yeah.
That's okay.
That's okay.
He could have taken that.
Yeah, he had a... So he had just 33% chance just to draw it.
Yeah.
And then he had the 37% chance to get it off that. So he was still in that game.
He actually was favorite.
Favorite with those odds, yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's Hearthstone.
Yeah.
Let's see what Phonetap has to say about the game.
Hey guys, sorry, I was actually talking to Phonetap about that game, but let's go ahead and just do it on camera. So Phonetap, let's talk a little bit about how that series progressed. It looked like maybe you were in position to take 3-0, and then Mech Shaman kind of floundered a little bit, but you managed to close the game in a really tight finish there. Walk me through the ups and downs of that series.
Well, in the Druid versus Paladin, I had to hope he didn't have the lay on hands, because if he had the second heal, I wouldn't be able to burst him down. So I was fortunate there. Then I was able to pull off the Hunter versus Paladin, which was killing Hunters all weekend. So that was really good for me. The Mech Shaman, man. it didn't do well the first two, but then against the Freeze Mage, I had the Lothab, and that's made the difference. And wow, I'm in the finals.
Absolutely. You're in the grand finals, and you know, TJ Azuma was saying that you're known amongst the pro players as a person who always helps other people practice and essentially help them shine. But this is your time to shine. You're in the grand finals and you're guaranteed $5,000. What does that mean to you so far?
I can't believe it. I mean, I didn't even predict myself. I don't know if anyone expected this. I definitely didn't. But I was happy to just get through the group stage, to be honest. But this is unbelievable.
A really heartwarming moment. The last question is, before we send you off and let you prepare for the grand finals, is you have Reynad versus Kit Kats coming up here. Do you have what it takes to go all the way against either of them?
I'll definitely do my best. But if it's against Reynad, that's a lot of pressure, though.
What about Kit Kats?
I mean, yeah, against Kit Kats, too, I guess. Yeah.
Well, we'll go one guest at a time. It's gotten this far, and we'll see how far you can actually go, Phonetap. Congratulations, he's the first finalist in the Season 2 Finals. Commentating along the casters.